Jordan from Berkeley, where he is the Hong Chen Distinguished Professor in the Departments of Electrical Engineering and Computer Science. He's one of the luminaries, I think it's the right word, of machine learning in the world, and we're very honored to have him here today. I won't go into, partly because I didn't bring my glasses, so I can't read very well. But there's a long list of things that I should have read out of his fellow of the National Academy of Sciences and Engineering, and so on, and so on. So I will not go through that, but I will just use this opportunity to give him a very warm welcome to UCI.
All right, thanks. It's a pleasure to be here to see John again, who I've known for many, many years. So we are living in an era where the confluence of data and computing and business models and society is seeming to change a lot of things. It feels like kind of a steam age or something like that. I'm going to use the words data science and these other buzzwords in the title. I know that everyone talks these days about AI and machine learning and so on. I think those words are not helpful. I think they're good as aspirations, but we don't have anything like AI, and I'm not sure I care. So I'm going to try to emphasize issues that I think are more important than trying to build an artificial intelligence system, which I just don't think we're going to be able to do in my lifetime, and I don't really think why do we have to build more humans? What's interesting, though, is that there is lots of data, and there are lots of things to do with that data, and human lives can change and may be made better, but there's lots of hard engineering challenges in facing that. So let's dig into that a little bit. What's new? It's not just there's large data sets. There's been large data sets for a long time, but there are data sets now that have information about every individual. So if you think about people, like social networks or whatever, there are data sets that have data about most individuals and some in various places. But individual could be a gene or a region of the sky, a habitat or whatever. So what it really means is there's now data at a different level of granularity. So you can make inferences or scientific discoveries at a much more fine-grained level. So you can say something about this gene, we know everything about it, and here's what it does. Or this subset of individuals, they have a certain pattern of behavior. So it's very different from the scientific point of view than I think ever in history. In history, scientists wanted to have general laws, F equals MA, that describe everything. And right now, what's changed is that we're interested in contextual laws. For this situation, what happens? And so the word personalization is often used for this. So personalized medicine is an example. It's not just enough to develop a treatment that works for all people, whatever that might mean. It's maybe not even clear that that's a reasonable aspiration, but to develop treatment regimes that work for specific people in specific situations, that's way more interesting. There's personalizations of all kinds. As soon as you start to make inference at the level of individuals, scientifically or in industry, there are long tail issues. There are facts that I have lots of data about some people, some individuals, and little data about others. How do I do things well for everybody? So huge issues that are unsolved come up, which I think about. So I'm going to emphasize that there's more unsolved issues than there are solved issues. I think that there's way too much hype right now about machine learning. It's just a collection of kind of regression techniques that learn mimic mappings from data in the world. That's not that big a deal. And it's not going to work on the problems that people really want it to work on. So let's focus on the hard challenges and be more honest about them instead of hyping our purported successes. So in particular, making timely, trustable, transparent inference of decision-making level individuals, I just don't think we have an academic discipline that supports that. So I'm going to try to make that more clear as I go to the talk. So to start to approach this, at least minimally, you have to combine computational fields with inferential fields. And somewhat surprising, I think that's mostly not been done. Computer scientists don't tend to think inferentially, and statisticians don't tend to think computationally. And so we have also sociological challenges. So let me try to say this. I'm going to do this somewhat quickly, but in kind of a fanciful way, but try to bring clear what the intellectual issues are. Let me just go ahead and put this whole slide up here. So let's imagine a student of mine that goes down to Silicon Valley, and they walk in, the boss on the first day of their job, the boss says, I have the following requirements. I need you to build a system that'll replace our classic service with a personalized service. So you can might imagine a search engine. It's a statistical engine that takes in data and improves search experience for people. And historically, they just made one search engine for everybody. But once you know the algorithm, you can apply that same algorithm to data from each individual. And you can now get 100,000 different search engines, and they're personalized. And that sounds easy to do, but you know, you have to build that system and make it really work. And that's a big inherent challenge, but maybe not so hard. But now the boss keeps adding requirements. It should work well for everybody, okay? So this is an interesting fact about Silicon Valley and about technology. When you test something out at the scale of, say, 10,000 people, these are statistical systems. You can get an error rate of, say, 0.05, that translates into, what, I don't know, 5 or 50 people who are getting bad service at any moment. That's not that small a number, but it's not big. And people will tolerate that, you know, that things just don't always work perfectly. But from one day to the next in Silicon Valley, you go from 10,000 people to 10 million people using your service. That's what happens. And these statistical algorithms don't know any better. They still have a 5% error rate. So suddenly you have 50,000 errors. And that means your system is just, you know, people write the newspapers, you know, this system doesn't work, you know, people complain, and you die. All right? So you can't talk to the VCs and the business people. You know this, so you can't tolerate that. So now you've got to work way harder. You've got to worry about not the mean of the distribution, but the whole distribution, the tail behavior. You have to control that. You have to really work hard. And now the academic background of someone who was able to do this needs to get to be pretty serious, and you know, not many people can do it. So a lot of companies fail for this reason. And then it only gets more interesting, because the boss notes that, oh, by the way, the system that you build, it needs to run just as fast as our classic service. And that's just, again, a fact of life in Silicon Valley. If you have a service that runs in, you know, it's like Google search. If you hit the return, you get an answer within a second or two. And that was true back in 1995, and people really noticed it. That was what made Google success. Before that, you hit a return, you maybe wait 10 seconds. So now that you've done that, you can never go back on that. You can never now have a new service that you roll out that's now better because it's personalized, but it runs slower. You know, people say, this is worse. You can't do that. All right, so now you have to build a system that controls errors in the tail and does it even though there's not just one model anymore, there's 100,000 models, still does it within, you know, 2 seconds. So that's very, very stringent. But then it gets even more interesting. The boss says, oh, by the way, as the years go on, it should never slow down. And that makes sense to the boss, because the boss says, well, you know, I've given you a terabyte of data about all these individuals, you built a system. I'm going to give you yet more data, and in 10 years you'll have exabyte of data. Surely the system can only be better because you have more data, right? But it can never slow down, right? So you're asking the person to design algorithms that somehow scale constant time as a function of the amount of data and still do good statistical inference. So we don't have a field that can deliver that, right? So at this point, companies just start spending lots of money to buy huge numbers of servers and hope it works and try it out. And it usually doesn't work, and they spend more money. And if they're a big company, they finally get there and they deliver something. If they're a small company, they usually die. Okay? There's other concerns that arise. Things, you know, the boss also mentions, oh, this data is being held by people. You got to be worried about privacy issues and so on and so forth. Okay, so I think of this, the metaphor I like to use is humans are like 3,000 years ago when people were learning how to build bridges and buildings. They had kind of very rough ideas. They tried things out. Some of them worked, some of them didn't. And sometimes the bridges fell down and people died and buildings fell down and so on. But, you know, the economies went forward and, you know, it was good overall. But eventually a field emerged. It's called civil engineering. And that field was able to sort of say things like, given this composition of the soil and this amount of wind and all, I can guarantee this bridge will never fall down, right? Up to 0.001 or whatever. And there's principle behind that. I assert that we have no such field for data, okay? People just try things out, and we have no principles for doing those kind of things. Saying, it's got to run in 2 seconds, I've got this amount of data, it's going to scale in this way, and I want to worry about the L infinity error and so on. We have nothing. We can just try things out, and they mostly don't work, and sometimes they work. All right, now, if it's just search, this is maybe not such a big deal. If you build it and it doesn't quite work, you know, no one's going to lose their life over that. But if you start doing this for medicine, rolling out medical decisions, personalized medicine decisions for hundreds of thousands of people worldwide every day, or transportation systems or financial systems or anything else, all the infrastructure people are trying to build, this will be a disaster that we can't guarantee the system will have some nice behavior. A lot of people will, are, in fact, right now, people are dying because of automated decisions being made, and they're bad decisions, and people's lives are being taken. Okay, so how are we going to start to worry about this? And, you know, instead of just hiding how great we are, how are we going to worry about, be honest about this? Right, well, I think we need to put together two thinking styles and start to prove new theorems that bring these styles together. So computational thinking, that's kind of a buzzword in the National Science Foundation, U.S. It's sort of aiming to show the breadth of computer science. And it's not just about writing programming languages and so on. It's about modularity, abstraction, and systems that are scalable and robust and, you know, transparent and all those other kind of things. So the field over 100 years, computer science is about 100 years old, you know, has done pretty well. You do a computer science class, you learn these kind of concepts, and they get to be part of your DNA. But there's another thinking style, which is not the same as just computational thinking. It's not just about the algorithms and the systems and all that. It's about taking incomplete snapshots of the world and going backwards and trying to infer what's out in the world. Okay, so that's called inferential thinking. And that's an older field, really 300 years old. And statistics is probably a major exponent, but you know, there's other inferential fields as well. Putting these two together is a major hard challenge, and that's kind of going to be one of my main themes in the talk. So in particular, if you just to be formal about this, or if you go to the theories and the core theories in statistics and computer science, statistical theory is called statistical decision theory, has a Bayesian and a frequentist version. And it has trade-offs among all kinds of quantities, among the amount of data, the complexity of the problem, the risk, the expected error, expected loss, and you get these nice trade-offs. You know, the risk scales as d log d over square root of n for some problem. And maybe that's a lower bound or upper bound. So there's maybe hundreds of thousands of papers that have theories like that. But you'll never find in any of those papers the word runtime mentioned. Or if it's mentioned, it's just totally informal. We ran the algorithm and it took this long. You can't trade off runtime with risk or amount of data. All right? And that theory. So that's a problem if you're trying to do what I had on what the boss was asking, is to say, I want this amount of runtime, 2 seconds, and I want your error rate to be, you know, 0.001 and the elementary norm. You can't do it in that theory. What about computer science? Does it have a kind of core computational complexity theory? Yeah, it does. There's several versions of it. You know, dating to Turing and others. But you will look in vain in that theory to find statistical risk. You know, the kind of expectations over data that are coming from a population, you just won't find it. So you can't trade off risk against computational complexity. So we really have a mismatch here, and brand new ideas are going to be needed. So let me just say a little bit about, so here's an outline. So I've been working on these kind of problems for about 10 years now, and some of them, you know, made some progress on, others I think are really, really hard. So I'm going to talk about just some little vignettes to give a flavor of this. One of them is privacy, just because it's kind of a fun topic to talk about. It's easy for me to say something concrete and give a couple of theorems. I think I'll skip the communication thing, and I'll go to the last part, which has to do with how optimization plays a role that links computational thinking and inferential thinking, somewhere in the middle. To me, at least, that's the last period of time been the most promising direction to pursue. That's a kind of theoretical kind of research. Okay, so a little bit on privacy. I am to go fast because I think that latter part is where I want to get to. But this is joint work with colleagues John Ducci and Martin Wainwright at Berkeley. And so I've already kind of alluded to this, but it's trying to take privacy seriously. We collect data from people. Maybe I collect your genome, and I want to use it to predict, you know, how long you're going to live. So you want some control over how I use that data. I mean, obviously, don't want just to publish the data, but you may want me to be careful about how I use the data so that an outsider looking at the analysis can't learn anything about you or even learn that you were in the data set. Okay? So if there's a data set sitting here of criminals, it'd be nice that I cannot detect that a particular individual is in that data or not. I can just use the data without, you know, you text such things. So one way to quantify how much loss of privacy you incur by someone's looking at the transformation of the data is by differential privacy. And it's really a likelihood ratio criterion that you can or cannot detect something in the data after it's been, noise has been added to it. So there's a nice burgeoning literature on that. But what it's that literature is not tended to do is be statistical. It is just, it uses probability just to randomize the data, but it doesn't then ask the question, what about the risk of using that data? Has it gone down? Has it gone, you know, how much has it gone down? In other words, you've added noise to the data, the predictions you're gonna make from the data are gonna probably be worse. Quantify that, okay? So I can know how much data I need to collect while I'm guaranteeing, making a privacy guarantee. All right, so we've been working on that. And let me set this up before I get to a kind of a theorem, by trying to make a little more clear this computational inferential thinking distinction. So let's be like a computer scientist right now thinking about a database. I've got a database, a query comes into it, and an answer comes out, which I'm gonna call maybe oddly theta twiddle. So think about a database like a classical banking data. I've got people in the database, I've got their age, their height, their weight, their address, and how much money they have in the bank. And queries might be in the form, who has the most money, what's the median amount of money, or whatever. Now, I want to protect the privacy of the people in the database, so I use, say, differential privacy or one of these other theories that tells me that I can add noise to the database, obtain a privatized database, and now certain things I cannot detect from looking at the privatized data about the original data. Okay? So I might not be able to detect that a particular person is in the original data. I can, in some sense, protect their privacy. And this theory guarantees that if you put in the same query to the privatized database, you will get an answer. Of course, it's different. You'll guarantee that this answer is close to the original answer that you would have gotten if you looked at all the data with high probability over Q and over all queries and over all databases. That kind of theory exists, and it's even starting to get to be useful. All right, so I started learning about this a few years ago. I asked the people that were working on this topic, well, this is great. Are you doing this inferentially? Is this kind of a statistical framework? And they said, sure, there's probabilities in there. It's inferential. Or maybe they would say, sure. The query can be compute the mean or the standard deviation, or even do a regression. Isn't that statistics? I say, no, you don't understand. That's just descriptive statistics. You're just describing the data. That's not inferential. And they'd say, what are you talking about? So I realized that I had a problem. The computer science kind of way of thinking wasn't kind of getting the idea. So I made another example, which is, let me show a different picture here, thinking inferentially about this same setup. So I've got a database, and a query comes in, I give it an answer. Right, but now let's imagine a different database. It's not banking data, it's medical data. So I've got people's age, height, weight, you know, where they live and all, but I also have how long they live if I give them a certain drug or a control. Okay, typical medical data. All right, now am I wanting to protect their privacy? Absolutely. So I've still got to privatize. But am I only interested in the people in the database? Okay, in the banking example, I'm only interested in the people in the bank, right? I don't really care about people who could have been in my bank but weren't in my bank. They didn't join my bank, so I don't care. In the medical data, it's completely opposite. I care about people who could have been in my database but just didn't happen to be because I took a sample. More in particular, the people in the database could be dead and gone, right? But that medical study could still be extremely useful. I didn't collect the data for the people in the study. I collected it for the next person who's going to come into my doctor's office, and I decide whether to give them the drug or not. Okay, measuring things about that. So that's inferential. When you say something, a phrase of the form, someone who could have been in the data but wasn't, right? That's an inferential assertion. Right? And in the classical database literature, you don't talk that language. You don't use that subjunctive tense. Okay. So how do you make formal mathematics out of could have been in the data but weren't? Well, you say, underline my data, there was a population, and I have to be clear on what that population is. It's not going to be everybody. And there was a sampling process that took the population and turned it into my specific data. I have to be clear about the sampling process. I will get different inferences if I make different assumptions about the sampling process. And now I want to be able to put in a query to the population, i.e., ask the same question of someone who could have been in the data but wasn't. I will get out an answer, and I want to guarantee that that answer is close to this answer with high probability over sampling and over all queries and overall p. Okay, so that kind of theory exists too. The statistics literature has hundreds of thousands of papers doing that. Okay, right. So I hope you see where I'm going. The real problem is to put the two together. Okay, the real problem is to gather data like in the banking, in the medical data, but realize that I'm trying to make inferences about people who are going to come in tomorrow, or could have been in the data but weren't, and guarantee the privacy nonetheless of the people whose data I took because I made a contract. So now I want to guarantee that this is close to theta. I don't mean Q with high probability overall S, over S and Q, and then overall queries and overall Q. Okay, so there are probably maybe 5 papers doing that. There's 100,000 doing the 2 separate things, none of which I think are all that useful. And just adding noise to a database and privatizing is very good if you say how much you've damaged the data for the purposes of inference. Yeah.
It's a question about the problem definition.
Yeah.
One of the things that people building stuff with conventional differential privacy find bummer is that if you do a lot of queries, you blow your privacy budget. And eventually you give away privacy.
That's orthogonal to what I'm talking about.
So you're not looking at
that's a major part of the issue, is that privacy is not easy. Right? And so there's a privacy budget. So we're going to dot differential privacy as our privatization site. But now, given that you say I have a privacy budget of alpha, maybe over multiple runs, alpha plus alpha, alpha 1, 2, I have a total budget, there are many ways to achieve that. One of them is to add a plus noise to the data. The other is to scramble in some other ways. There's a whole bunch of ways to do it. Now, some of those will completely ruin the data for the purpose of the inference I'm trying to do. Others will preserve the data for the purpose of the inference. Which one should I use? The literature doesn't talk about that. That's what we're focusing on. How much does the risk go down under a particular queue? Okay, so we worked on what's called local privacy. Let me not get into too many details, but just the picture will kind of show you. I have people holding data privately, X1 through XN. It'll go through a channel, which will noise it up, and then Z1 to Zn can be showed to a central statistician, and the risk will now have gone up, and we want to quantify that. Okay, so I'm just summarizing on one slide. There's a long paper about this. It's kind of a discussion paper coming out this spring in the Journal of the American Statistical Association. And let me just not get into a lot of details, but I want to go right through this equation, just every piece of it, so you understand how we set the problem up. Okay, so we're being statisticians. We need to find a loss function. We have the data, which is the fuzzed up data, and the statistician gets to see that. And then compare their output to the truth. This is just some function of the underlying P. Okay? That loss function, you hit it with an expectation, so you take the average loss, this is called the risk in statistics, this is decision risk. And the average over all the randomness, this is the algorithmic randomness, so that you would probably do in computer science, average of the algorithmic randomness, but this is critically the statistical randomness, the population that you don't gave rise to the data, if you know what that population is. Okay, so that's just a number, it's called the risk function, it's a function of the amount of data n, of the dimension of d of theta, and other statistical parameters. But it's also a function of P. And so Wald in the 1930s said, let's look at the maximum risk as one way to turn this into a single number. And then let's take the best procedure over the maximum risks. So that's called minimax, still very much alive to this day. And so from the blue on, this is what these hundreds of thousands of papers will do. They will set up a particular problem, a theta, P, and so on, and study that thing as a function of all the parameters. Does it go as d log d over square root of n, and so on? All we've done is to add this little green part right here. We're taking a furthering theorem over all channels which respect, say, differential privacy to some level alpha. Now, differential privacy, there's this parameter alpha, which if you set it to 0, you guarantee perfect privacy. You just added so much noise to the data, there's nothing, no one can say anything about the data anymore. As alpha gets bigger, like a half, then you've added some noise, but you still, now people can start to infer certain things about the data. And if alpha goes all the way to infinity, you're adding no noise to the data, you're just delivering. Okay? So it's a little knob you can turn, and each individual, when they give their data, they should be able to be asked, what is the alpha you want me to use for this data? How much privacy protection do you want? Okay? And I, as a statistician, should make a guarantee. I will protect it that way, because I will ask the correct amount of noise for that situation, and I will protect it in numbers of queries. So anyway, this is a well-defined object here. And it's parameterized by alpha. As I change alpha, the symptom will get smaller as alpha gets larger. So we can now ask, can we do the mathematics of this thing just the same way people have done the mathematics of minimax? And long story short, we were able to do that because this is a well-defined set here. We're able to adapt techniques from applied mathematics and information theory and so on to solve this thing for various classes of problems. And so what should happen if you solve this problem is that you should get equations that you get out of classical statistics, like d log d over square root of n, but alpha should appear somewhere in that equation too. It's a parameter of the minimization. So how does it appear? Does it appear in an interesting way? So let me just to set this up, I'll show you a concrete example of doing this. Let's suppose people are coming into hospitals and they're admitted for abuse of substances. This particular person is abused alcohol and cocaine.
pain in that would be pleasant. I'd like to be able to infer in the underlying population what are the actual true proportions, how many people in the city abuse alcohol, cocaine, and so on. If I knew these numbers, I'd know how many hospitals to build, how many doctors to put in each hospital, and so on. I don't know these numbers, and so classic, I just gather a huge data set of ones and zeros, take sample proportions, maximum likelihood estimates, and they approach these things uniformly well, and so on. But no one wants to reveal data like that. I add noise to that data. All right, how much loss do I incur in terms of inferring these things if I add noise? All right, so this is a problem. If I didn't have privacy, I could just easily solve it. The first year graduate student exercise to get the risk as a function of the amount of data. It's that infimum of the supremum. It's minimax. And here is the minimax risk. It turns out to be logarithm of the dimension of theta divided by square root of x. Okay? There it is. So I'm not going to get into details, but just this is something that you can do if you've had any bit of statistics at all. So you do that by solving that infimum of supremum of risk. Now what if we add the further infimum over all differential privacy channels? We're trying to pick the best channel that gives you the best risk, not just any arbitrary channel of differential privacy of little alpha. How does alpha appear in the equation? And it appears in a very neat way. It just multiplies n with a square. Okay, what does this mean? Well, it means if I'm going to go to each of you and I'm going to ask for your, say, your genome, some data from you. And you're going to ask me, we're going to have a dialogue. You're going to ask me, well, what problem are you trying to solve, i.e., what is your loss function? And I'll say, maybe I want your genome because I'm studying a disease that runs in your family. And you'll say, okay, great for that. You can set alpha to something very large because, you know, I believe in that problem so much that I don't mind a little loss of privacy. Or I might say, well, I'm using it to set the insurance rates in your part of the city. And you say, well, okay, that's a socially important thing to do. I want you to use my data, but, you know, set alpha to a half because I really want to protect you. You have some pretty good protection. Or I could say, well, I want to use it to place ads on your browser. And you say, no, you set alpha to zero. So you get to do that. Now, so I say, okay, fine, I guarantee, I write a contract that you have that. But I do that for everybody in the room, you all have a different output. Then I gather your data, and I add noise in the way I promised, right? And then I use that noised up data to fit some model, make some prediction about, you know, who will have what disease and so on, okay? And in doing so, I've got a worse model than I would have had if I'd used the original data. How much worse? All right, well, it's this quantity right here. This is the risk. This is exactly what you want to measure. So if you say, I go to John and say, I want your genome, and we have this little dialogue, he says, okay, for me, I'll be comfortable with alpha equals a half. And I think we'll all learn what things like alpha mean in the future, just like we learned what a euro means. You don't know what about euros is. Pounds. So, you know, you'll learn what that feels like to have an alpha equals a half. So John will say, alpha equals a half. I say, fine, I'll square that. That's 1/4, and I multiply the n. I just got that. To get the same risk as before, I just got to collect 4 times as much data from people like John as I would have had to collect if you had no alpha. Right? And so that's an example of civil engineering of data science. That's a thing I can know to make a guarantee to my boss I will get a certain error rate. I know how much data to collect. I've made some guarantees. Okay? Now, the cool thing is that this is really a general law. So we studied it for a whole bunch of different problems, and this law of take n and you multiply alpha squared comes out in all cases. And there's a mathematical reason for that. But for a wide class of problems. We think of this as something of a law of private data analysis. It tells you how the risk will go down as if you put statistics together with differential privacy. Okay, so that was a little exercise. I think I will skip this because I want to get to some of the other material. You can now ask, that just tells you about the risk. Is there a mechanism? What is the mechanism now to add noise to the data? And if you just look at the literature, there's a whole bunch of different mechanisms. The typical one is add Laplace noise. Turns out, the theory, you can now ask, in the theory, how much worse risk will you have if you add Laplace noise, say in the particular problem I showed you, of drug treatments. And it turns out, bad. So it guarantees privacy, but it hurts you too much, a lot for the risk. Okay? Is there a better mechanism? Yes, there is. And so I have it on this slide, but I think I've decided to skip this. There's another mechanism which we propose which has the optimal risk. It reaches the lower bound. And this is actually with real data. This is add Laplace noise. This is the L infinity error, that Spurgeon error I was talking about, the sample size. That's add Laplace noise, and this is this other mechanism. So on a log scale, it's just way, way better. So this actually gives you practical procedures for particular differential privacy guaranteeing mechanisms that don't mess up your data too much, or using it for statistics.
Okay, so I'm going to move on to the second part of the talk, but that same basic idea can be used in other problems. So here's an example. Suppose I've got so much data on a bunch of geographically separated sites that I cannot transmit all the data back to a central site. Maybe it's really exabytes. It would take days. So what I have to do is compress the data and send a compressed version. And the central site gets to use the compressed data. It's lossy compression. And build a statistical model based on the compressed data. Obviously, their risk will be higher than if they had been able to use all the data. How much? Right? And now you can ask the parallel question, how do I compress so that I don't damage the data too much for the purpose of inference? And you might think that Shannon solved this problem. Why didn't he solve the compression problem? Well, no, he did it just like different privacy. He solved the problem of, if I'm just trying to compress and get the smallest description, how do I do that? Okay, so you need a new Shannon theory, which is, how do I compress, get a small description, but don't damage the data too much for the purposes of statistics? Right? And you can now solve that problem with the same approach. You just put a new infimum in front of everything. That's an infimum over all channels with a certain bit rate, a bandwidth, that's right. And now you could take the further infimum, and you could even add privacy in there, too, to take the two infimums. And it is some math, but it's kind of good math. You need to do this kind of math. It's the core of the problem. And we were able to do that and have some papers about that too, showing interesting trade-offs of bandwidth against statistical risk. Okay, so now you might say, well, you solve all kinds of problems this way. Can you go back to the requirement that I have a time budget on my statistical inference and just say, okay, I want to get a statistical inference over all computational mechanisms that run in 2 seconds. That would solve the problem that I was referring to earlier. Okay? The problem is that I have no idea how to set that up. And we don't have a well-deformed computational complexity that says things of the form, here's the set of all computational mechanisms that run in a certain amount of time. So Turing, in some sense, aimed to do that, but his theory is so coarse that it provides, it's not of any value for this situation. For example, Turing has a one-tape machine and a two-tape machine, right? They're equivalent for his theory, because they both, there's a polynomial time transformation between the two. And so everything that's polynomial time translatable is lumped in the same class. Well, that's the inside of that class is where we want to operate, because polynomial time is a huge difference. I want to know, is it logarithmic time or is it linear time? I don't want to know that it's d to the 15th, right? And if you set up these kind of ideas using two-tape versus one-tape, all the statistical constants, the n, the theta, the d, et cetera, are differ between the one-tape and two-tape machine. So that theory is just not helpful. All right, so long story short, I think this is the open problem of our era. We're going to need a new Kolmogorov or Turing or whatever to help solve this. So in the meantime, this is the kind of things I've been doing for the last 10 years, working on various attempts to bring the risk together with runtime. One approach used convex geometry to relate the two. There's relationships between runtime and geometry from the theoretical CS community. And we developed a parallel relationship between risk and convex geometry. And therefore, as one goes up, the other goes down. So that was great. If we could have done that on all kinds of problems, that would be kind of the end of the story. But we could only do it on one problem called the denoising problem. And after that, it got to be too complicated. We also tried using some ideas from database theory. And here's kind of the one that many people have worked on, including us. If I have a big data set, what if I subsample it? If I subsample it, again, I'm going to get worse performance because I'm not using all my data. How much worse? And if you could quantify that, then you can say how much to subsample or how much parallelism to use to run faster while still giving myself an acceptable risk. So this is ongoing, and this is kind of hard. Again, we don't have a good complexity theory of computer science that allows us to trade off these things quantitatively. The complexity theory of computer science allows you to say it's polynomial or not polynomial. That doesn't even say that very well. We don't know if P is equal to infinity. So we need something much more fine-grained. So what more fine-grained thing is there out there? Well, optimization theory. So optimization theory is not just a source of algorithms. It is that, and people use them a lot. It actually is a source of lower bounds. And the lower bounds are pretty good. They often match up existing upper bounds. So it's actually a little mini kind of complexity theory that can start to be brought into contact with statistical inference. And so that's what I'm going to talk about in my second half. Okay, so a lot of buzzwords in this title, but basically the story is going to be here that
there's a notion of lower bounds and optimization. And we need to think about what those lower bounds mean. There's a notion of kind of the best you can do, and if you have a certain optimization problem, what's the fastest you can go? Okay? Someone might propose some algorithm that goes at some speed, and someone else has a better algorithm that goes maybe faster. Or if you reach the best you can do, right? And once you reach the best you can do, it's not that you're just done, that that's the final algorithm. You've now learned something, because they'll be kind of, you script in that way all the inessential parts, and you kind of look for the essentials, and you can probably relate those to other theories. So we're interested in lower bounds. And it turns out that to get lower bounds in optimization, we believe you need to go into continuous time, number one. So most of computer science and optimization are done in discrete time. And eventually, everyone kind of knew that that would break down. And I think this is where it hits, that you cannot do that, the theory in discrete time. And moreover, once you go into continuous time, you can use sort of variational and Hamiltonian symplectic ideas that kind of flowed through physics for several centuries. They can start to be used productively to talk about lower bounds. Okay, so this work with, I want to highlight my students here, Andrew and this one, Aisha Wilson, have worked with me for 2 years on this and have done really very, very much of the hard work here. And Mike Betancourt of Columbia is a colleague who's joined us in some of the later parts of this work. Okay, so I've already said this, but let me just sort of say it more clearly. Optimization is a central place in our field. It supplies algorithms, but it also provides lower bounds. When I started learning optimization, it was in the 80s, and it was kind of viewed as a finished field. There was good algorithms like the simplex algorithm or the conjugate gradient. They had known rates. There was good software. It was kind of done. But right around that time, mostly in Russia, people were revolutionizing the field. Interior point methods were developed that were very different. And then lower bound ideas came out, and that changed the field a lot. And that's the class of ideas that had this big impact on machine learning. Okay. Now, surprisingly, these two revolutions have actually created all kinds of open new problems. So this field is now a very, very lively field, as lively as anything I know about. All right, so let me try to say this in a somewhat grandiose way, but to make my point, which is that the most mature fields are ones that use both integration and differentiation. Okay? Those two perspectives, you go back and forth between them in a really mature field. So the original version of this was mechanics. So Newtonian mechanics is based on derivatives. F equals ma is a law involving derivatives. And so Newton wrote those down, and then to actually get the trajectories, you had to integrate them. 100 years later, Lagrange came along around, and he said, I can write that all the, instead of working derivatives, I can transform those problems into integrals. I can write the integral of an energy and optimize over that. And I can get out the same physics, exactly the same physics. And then ever since then, people in physics go back and forth between these two perspectives, differential equations on the one hand and integral equations or variational perspectives on the other hand. Statistics is full of going back and forth, the probability statistics. Saddle point expansions are ways to do integrals by using derivatives. Talleyrand's work, if you know anything about that, and probability is full of arguments that involve fundamental theorem of calculus. And then the numerical disciplines that are most mature do this too. So finite element analysis takes partial differential equations, i.e. things expressed in terms of derivatives, and rewrites them in terms of little integrals and relates those integrals to each other. And then Monte Carlo, the best Monte Carlo algorithms are trying to do sampling for doing integrals, but they use derivatives to get kind of a notion of momentum. So I could go on, but I think there's some sort of sense that maturity happens when you really use the fundamental theorem of calculus deep. And if you ask about optimization, I would say in this sense, it's immature. It's just a derivative-based field. You'll write repapers in optimization. They have all kinds of vectors and Hessians and so derivatives, and you'll never see the integral sign in any of the papers, or maybe just for a Tegel expansion, or something. All right, so let's try to bring a variational perspective to bear on optimization. So why would we want to do this? Well, because there are lower bounds that are expressed well by taking that perspective. So let's look at the simplest possible settings so we can get clear on this. Let's try to do just convex optimization. I have a convex function f, unconstrained. Here's a specific algorithm, it's gradient descent. So you step in the direction of the gradient according to a certain step size. Now you can do theory on that. You can show that over that class of functions, that this algorithm will converge at a rate of 1 over k, meaning that if I've done k steps of the algorithm, I'm guaranteed to be in a ball of size 1. some functions you do better, like the flat function, you're at the minimum when you start, but there are functions that have that rate, so this is a worst case rate. Now, that kind of analysis has been done for lots of other procedures in optimization. That's kind of where things were at in the 80s. People write down an algorithm and analyze it. At some point, Nemirovsky and others in Russia asked the question, can we develop a complexity theory of optimization? I.e., what's the best you can do for this problem? And they didn't borrow Turing-style complexity. That would not have been helpful. They developed their own. And in that complexity theory, it's called the Oracle model, you're able to show that for this class of problems, the lower bound is 1 over k squared faster. Okay? Epsilon goes as 1 over k squared. So it's k gets large, error rate goes down quadratic. All right, now that's just a mathematical statement that's a lower bound. How do you know that it's a tight lower bound? Well, you exhibit some algorithm that has a rate of 1 over k squared. So is there such an algorithm? Well, I'm not clear that it exists because this algorithm is, steepest descent. Right, now we've got to be more clear about this complexity theory. It's over what class of computational mechanisms? Right? Well, if we're over like Turing machines, well, you can have a super Turing machine that's able to look at the description of the function and just jump to the answer. Wouldn't be very interesting. So instead, the complexity theory here said, well, it's a convex function. I'm going to allow you to look at function values and gradients, and I'm going to insist that every step you make is in a linear span of all previous gradients. Okay? It's a particular model. It's a very powerful one. It includes gradient descent, conjugate gradient, and a whole bunch of other things, finite law states. So it can solve all kinds of problems, but it's not everything. It's not a Turing machine. In that model, the lower bound is 1 over k squared. Okay, so in that model, since you're only allowed to use gradients, this seems like a pretty good algorithm. At every step, it takes the steepest direction downhill. Right. So it was somewhat of an open problem for a while whether there's an algorithm that achieved 1 over k squared. It was a surprise that it was discovered. In 1983, Nesterov wrote down a two-piece algorithm, not just one piece. One piece does a bit of gradient descent, and the other does a little bit of kind of extrapolation, if you will. Right? Fine. He came up with this algorithm. He's sort of a genius. He knows how exactly he came up with it. But more importantly, he analyzed it and showed that its rate was 1 over k squared. Right? So, Newton discovered this, and Nesterov came along quite a number of years later and discovered this. All right, now, how can you understand this? How did he come up with this? And how was the general principle underlying this? I'd say to this day, since 1983, it's still not clear. Okay? So in the meantime, people have taken a whole bunch of other gradient-based methods, smear descent, cube comparison, and so on, and accelerated them. And they just basically kind of followed the algebra of Nesterov and used similar algebra and have developed accelerated versions of all these algorithms. Here's this part, there's a huge list. And these algorithms are faster, and often they meet the lower bounds. If people work out the lower bounds. Now, there's a bunch of mysteries here. No one really knows where these are coming from, but also, for example, these are not even descent methods in general. So you're at some point, the classical methods are necessarily go downhill at every step. These methods can go back uphill. Right? That seems kind of puzzling, almost paradoxical. If you're trying to get downhill as fast as possible, does it make ever any sense to go back uphill? The answer is yes, it does. Okay, so these kind of things I don't believe are well understood if you just stay in discrete time. In discrete time, you really don't have a well-defined notion of acceleration. You're hopping among points. Right? What does it mean to go faster? Right? Acceleration is a differential notion. You need the real numbers. Okay, so if we go to continuous time, I should say that we are going to go to continuous time now. I know that a lot of people in computer science went to computer science because they didn't like differential equations. And so you can go into continuous time and analyze gradient descent. It's called gradient flow in continuous time. And this is the algorithm. It's a differential equation. You solve the gradient. And it has a rate. And the rate, not too surprisingly, is 1 over t. After t times the units of flow, t units of time have gone past, you're within 1 over t of the answer, of the bottom of the hill. Okay, so you can now ask, what about that two-step equation of Nesterov? From this differential equation, I can discretize it. I can do Euler discretization. X at time t plus 1 is equal to x at t minus the gradient. At x of t. And that algorithm is gradient descent. So I can discretize this thing. But I can also go backward, like I start with gradient ascent and take the step size of zero and get that differential equation. Right? What if I go backwards for Nesterov algorithm? I take the step size to zero. I will get a differential equation. What differential equation do you get? And this was addressed in a paper in 2014. These authors found this differential equation. So you see it's second order, not too surprising that I had two equations in the discretization. It had a funny three there, and it's non-homogeneous. So you can't solve this thing, but you can sort of you can analyze it with Bessel functions. You can start to understand how it's oscillating, going up and down, and so on. So we saw this equation, and we saw this paper, and said, is there an underlying generative interpretation of this? Where does this come from? Why is this the best equation? Why is this achieving the oracle rate? No obvious reason that it should. And so it's just like Lagrange, who I think looked at F equals MA, and he said, why F equals MA? It's just some differential equation. Is there an underlying thing that's being optimized to deliver that differential equation? Okay, so that's what we are trying to do, and I'm now going to write down our Lagrangian that delivers that differential equation, but not only that differential equation, it delivers essentially all of the differential equations corresponding to accelerated methods. So in some sense, it's a characterization of these accelerated methods in some generality. So here is the Lagrangian. So I'm now starting to do some real math. People are still watching the slide, that's good. All right, so this is just a function of time, t. It's a function of the position, x, as you're moving through this optimization space, and moreover, the velocity, x dot, okay? That first thing right there is called a Bregman divergence. I'll explain that in the next slide, but it's a measure of distance between x, where you currently are, and x plus a time-scaled velocity. Alpha, beta, and gamma are just time-scalings to give me not just one algorithm, but a whole family of algorithms. I can set alpha, beta, gamma how I want, and I get different algorithms. Well, those aren't the important part. There's the degrees of freedom. But anyway, I have a measurement to where I am and a little bit of where I might look like I'm going. So it's kind of an elasticity or an energy term. Then I have a time-scaled version of the function, and this looks like kind of a potential energy. If that's a kinetic energy, it's potential to do. This is a Lagrangian, which is kinetic minus potential. All right. Now, let me show you what the Bregman divergence is. Bregman divergence is this formula right here. It's just you take the linearization of an auxiliary function h, you choose this function h, it's a part of the design of the algorithm, and you linearize the function x, and you compute this discrepancy here, and that red amount is the distance between x and y using h as an auxiliary function. If h is the quadratic function, this is just completely distant. Variational way we'll talk about including distance. So anyway, we allow ourselves an arbitrary Bregman divergence between x and x plus x dot. Okay? So given that Lagrange, what do you do with Lagrangians? Well, you do what Lagrange told us to do, which is that, let's go back to that. What was that slide? Yeah. You put it into an integral. Here's where the integral critically is occurring. That's just now a number for any path, and you normalize over all paths. So this path might have the minimal value and the other path doesn't, right? And then Lagrange and others, Euler, figured out the mathematical way to solve this thing is you take some derivatives of that function up there and you set it to zero, or you do this, these are called the Lagrange equations. These are like necessary conditions for optimal. It's like set all the partial derivatives to zero. So this is an easy exercise. You can do it yourself in two or three lines. Take that function and do some partial derivatives and a time derivative. And what pops out will be a differential equation. And so I'm going to show you that differential equation. Where is it? Here it is, the bottom slide you can see. Okay? So this is a master differential equation I claim contains all of the known acceleration methods, at least all of them I know about. So it's second order, it has a non-homogeneous term for the damping, and it has a bunch of geometric terms here that multiply the gradient. Inside of that equation is the one for Nesterov that I showed earlier, but a whole bunch of others are inside of it. Right. Now that alone is not all that interesting, but you learn other mathematical things by going down this approach. The answer is yes. So in particular, you can ask, is there a convergence rate associated with this differential equation? Then I've talked about that in general. Because usually, for each specific algorithm, you have to do a convergence analysis. And it's two or three pages of Jensen's inequality and Cauchy-Schwarz and all that. Is it possible to get a conversion rate
once and for all for this master differential equation? The answer is yes, and moreover, it's a one-line proof. So here is the convergence rate. You've got to choose that parameter beta. Whatever you chose goes into that equation. You get exponential n minus beta as your convergence rate. And the proof is one line. You simply write down a function which is called a Lyapunov function. It uses the Bregman divergence in a particular way, a little differently. You take its time derivative, and you ask that that time derivative be negative. That means we're going downhill. This happens if and only if that condition is achieved. Okay, so that is the proof that that is the convergence rate. Okay, now I've got just a couple minutes left, I think. So let me sort of stop the slides for a second and skip to the main. So what more can you learn from this, and now what's left to do? Okay, so what's happened here is that we seem to be able to get any rate we want. I can choose beta, I told you, that's the degree of freedom. So if you want an exponential rate, you can put in beta just equal to t. If you don't want to try to be so ambitious and get an exponential rate, if you want that polynomial rate, like 1 over t, do we need to finish?
We need to finish in the next 2 minutes.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. right. What happens? What happens if you set beta different values? All right. So if you set beta to logarithm t, you're going to get a rate of 1 over t. And we know that rate is achievable. It's with gradient flow. I could also set it to be logarithm of 2t. I get 1 over t squared. That's actually achievable also at something called mirror flow, mirror descent flow. Right? As I use other logarithms, other powers, I can get another bunch of other algorithms. And some of these are new, but you can achieve all of them. If I actually say, I'm going to set beta to to t, so I get an exponential rate, in continuous time, you can achieve that. And what's happening is that this Lagrangian has the property of being covariant, meaning that no matter what beta I choose, I will always follow the same path, all right? And all that's happening is I'm moving along the path faster or slower. It's just I'm using a different clock. It's like Einstein said, the clock doesn't really matter. So what we have discovered here is an optimal way to optimize. It's the path in this volume, in this phase space. That's invariant to the algorithm, right? And changing the rate is not that important. It's just using a different clock, right? But so that means in continuous time, you can go as fast as you want. It's not actually interesting. Acceleration phenomena is not interesting other than the path, right? But now what if I need to go back to discrete time and do an algorithm that runs on a computer? I know I can't get an exponential rate. I know I have an oracle lower bound, 1 over t, 1 over k. So something must be breaking. I must be able to take that differential equation, which works in continuous time, and not be able to turn it into a discrete time equation, okay? And so that's what happened in our research. About a year ago, we realized this was the issues, and I'm gonna skip over some slides here and just go to the mysteries. Why can't we discretize the dynamics when we're using x-ray clocks? This difference equation, somehow you can't discretize it, okay? What happens when you arrive at a clock speed where you can discretize? There must be some transition of some kind, all right? And then how do you discretize what's possible, all right? Those questions can't even be posed if you're just working discrete time. You have to embed the problem in the continuous time framework to talk about these transitions, right? So we're in the continuous time framework, and now those questions can all be solved, and the way they're solved is by learning about something called symplectic integration. This is a field that goes back, and I think I'll put up one last slide and just stop with that. It goes back to Hamilton, Jacobi, and Macquarie and others in the late 1800s, and they were asking about how do I discretize differential equations so that I exactly conserve energy or momentum or the quantums in physics, right? If I just discretize naively a differential equation, I'll have an approximation, but also I will probably have an approximate energy and an approximate momentum. And as the thing continues over in time, I will bleed away energy momentum. I will do bad physics. And they said, how can I not do bad physics? How can I discretize and exactly conserve the quantities of nature? And it's a beautiful theory called symplectic geometry. It exists to this day in most mathematics departments. And it turns out that you can develop symplectic integrators for our differential equation. And once you do, you also get a theory that says when the symplectic integrator can be done, when it cannot be done, and what happens when it can be done. So we can solve all those mysteries. And so I think I had a slide, and so here's the last slide. If you now apply that theory to our setup, you work with not the Bregman-Lagrangian, but you transform this into a Hamiltonian, you apply the symplectic integrator, here is the convergence of this algorithm, that is exactly 4 over 8. So our theory exactly predicts what the algorithm should be. So in some sense, we've started to understand S-drop acceleration. I've now run out of time. Let me just say that this was about a year ago this was done, and in the last year we've had a flurry of things for non-convex optimization, saddle point avoidance, acceleration around saddle points, a whole bunch of things. So if you want to look on my website, you'll see all these papers. And they all use a Hamiltonian underlying it. So it's, by going into this framework and borrowing some physics ideas, you've been able to have a whole new perspective on things, including the diffusions, Langevin diffusions, and the MCMC kind of ideas. That's really getting started right now, but that's where we're going. So I'm going to stop there. Thank you.